From land to air, now to the high seas, I would like now like to invite Rear Admiral P.J. Randachari for his presentation on the session.
Dr. Satish Kumar, CCR&D, distinguished academicians, ladies and gentlemen who are specialists in various fields, a very good morning to all of you. In the next 10 minutes or so, it shall be my endeavor to put across to you some of the areas of great interest to us. And as I try to do this, I would also like to highlight firstly the environment in which we operate. As you all aware, a naval platform is a complex conglomerate of several equipment and systems all unified together into a hull to perform certain roles for which she has been designed. This is one part of it. The second part of it is, of course, largely dependent on the kind of equipment, the kind of systems, the type of threats that are there, and the type of advances that the adversary has made. Taken together, it simply means that the kind of equipment, the systems, and the ships that we have will have to be far more superior to start with, which of course is dependent on the extent of research and the technology that we have at our disposal. Now, coupled with this, just going to the next step, the systems are so integrated that they are strongly coupled. There is severe interaction between systems, and anything that is done to a particular system obviously affects the other. There is a great amount of energy balance that is there within the platform. So against this backdrop, therefore, there is a requirement to look at various areas, though apparently they are different fields. Again, there is some kind of an unison at various levels, whether it's in material technology or in any other niche area that we are looking at. And that becomes a force multiplier even as we look into it. Now, the platform, because by virtue of its roles, obviously has several conflicting parameters within it. And to start with, it would have been designed to optimize its performance against various parameters which are apparently in conflict, which can be anything from cost, which is a unit production cost, to true life cost, to technology, to technical risk, to type of signatures that we want, to the availability, reliability, and maintainability aspects, to the kind of indigenous production that is possible, and so on. Now, at this point, I just like to highlight one important aspect. The Navy has been very fortunate to recognize this early, maybe in the 60s, and we started off indigenous production of our ships. A modest beginning was made, and ships are being built indigenously today in the Navy, with several equipment also being indigenously built. Some of the weapon systems are also getting integrated, manufactured, designed and manufactured indigenously. But then, as I said, depending on the threat levels, depending upon what the adversary has, depending upon the improvements in technology, the advances made in each of the fields, there is a requirement to revisit continuously and keep effecting improvements in all areas of interest to us. So against this backdrop, I just want to highlight some of the requirements for us. We would be interested in developing a package for dynamic simulation of propulsion systems. That's one area. There are various types of propulsion systems that we can have. A large number of them are there in various combinations. We would like to have something that models, simulates, and understands the propulsion system in a complex, harsh environment such as the sea, where it is non-linear, it is uncertain, and therefore you need to account for all of these factors through mathematical models and find solutions which can help us in designing propulsion systems which have a higher performance indices, reliable under such conditions of operation, and of course they are able to have a longer life during the course of exploitation. Then we recognize also that great strides have been made world across in the area of electric propulsion what is variously termed as integrated power systems, integrated full electric propulsion system, or simply the integrated electric propulsion system. So we need to have, we need to have models, and we need to simulate the power systems that are necessary. Why is this important? If you recollect what they say to RM said, we are looking at high energy weapons. Now, if you think about it, about high energy weapons, let us say like a railgun, operating from a ship, you need powers to the tune of about 20 megawatts and plus. Now, obviously, if we have a conventional system, this power gets locked when we are propelling at lower powers. So, to unleash this power, we need an integrated power system which makes itself available for such operations. And therefore, electric propulsion becomes one of the important requirements. It also gives the flexibility. Now, having said it, then you need to look at, firstly, you need to model and simulate the electric propulsion system as a whole, as an entity. And thereafter, you have to convert that simulation and modeling into products that which I will list out separately as to what we can do. Things like superconducting motors, permanent magnet motors, advanced induction motors, and so on, naturally become products of interest because they fit into the ambit of things as we look at it. Then we need to have packages which can be used for modeling and simulation of ship motion. That is basically for combined maneuvering, station keeping, and sea keeping. Again, it's in a complex environment. There will be 6 degrees of motion of freedom, and therefore we need to have solutions for such operations. It may not converge. It may get into partial differential equations and so on. But the fact of the matter is that such requirements are there as part of research. Then we need to also model and simulate and understand various types of propulsors. The kind of propulsors that are in use today range from fixed pitch propellers, contour rotating propellers, controllable pitch propellers, all kinds of other propulsion systems, water jet propellers, or you just name it, they are in use. These will need to be understood and ushered as part of technology into the Navy for meeting various mission requirements. Similarly, we also need to get into areas of other auxiliaries and electric machinery for future combatants. This can have various paradigms. It can be from a simple thing such as variable capacity centrifugal pumps, canned motors, magnetic bearings, superconducting motors, etc. Each of them has various advantages. I am not getting into those aspects. Then we also need to create something called a propulsion system integration development environment, which is important, because it effectively integrates all functions related to not just the propulsion system integration. It has multifarious fields in it. It has thermal engineering, it has material engineering, it has got metallurgical engineering, it has a whole lot of other aspects built into it. And therefore, it's an important niche area for us to be looking into. Then we look at the next area, which is the air-independent propulsion systems. We have various types of systems within that. But one that is of interest to us would be fuel cell technology. Now, great strides have been made within the country, but research is still going on. Some of them are converted into prototypes. But if you look at other countries, German Navy, for instance, it uses proton exchange membrane fuel cell. The membrane that is available there is proprietary to them. So similar such things are being developed within the country also. So we need to look at fuel cell technology as a viable option because it enhances the capabilities of a submarine, for instance. It enhances the dived endurance and so on. Then the next important area, which is common to all of us, whether it is in the Army, Navy or the Air Force, is the condition monitoring and fault diagnostic tools, which is an important area, which can range from simple handheld devices, starting from vibration to oils to signal processing techniques to acoustic, parametric, non-parametric, etc. And of course, we need to have something which is based on artificial intelligence, neural networks and such areas. So we need to have condition monitoring and fault diagnostic tools, either as a built-in system for the equipment or as handheld ones which can be used on board. Then we need to look at design of or infrared suppression systems. Then we have the heating, ventilation and air conditioning systems, what is commonly termed as the HVAC systems, which can be used on board. Then we need, depending on the acoustic signature that is required, we need to have tuned mass dampers to be developed for specific applications to take care of certain frequencies of interest. That is again an area of interest. And one of the areas which is very important, which has been highlighted by my armed forces colleagues earlier, is that we are interested in predicting the residual life of components of systems, which is an important area. The reasons for which have already been highlighted by the other two speakers. So we need to have methods. We may like to get into fracture mechanics, for instance, as a field, to find out what is the residual life of this component with so many micro millimeters of crack, and how is it going to propagate. We need to get into such areas. And we need to also look at damping materials for stealth. And we need to look at composite superstructures which are necessary for the lightweight, getting into composites and so on. Mounting systems is another area. Designing of composite propellers, composite pipes, and norms for mounting equipment on a raft, which obviously will have its own, it needs to be designed specifically so that the underwater radiated noise levels are minimum, and the raft with the equipment that is installed on it is able to absorb all of those. So a typical vibration problem, if you like it. And another important area is we need to design equipment for shock. If you imagine a 10-ton TNT exploding in the vicinity of the ship, the kind of shock waves that it is going to produce and the impact that it is going to have on the equipment and on the ship's hull is something that you can visualize. So we need to design equipment for shock. We need to understand shock and we need to design equipment for shock. Then we need to have vibro-acoustic tiles, for instance, for submarines. We need to have radar absorbing paints. Then we need to have detection algorithms which are complex and which are based on, which are robust, stable, and which are required in sonars. Then we need to have high thickness epoxy coatings which for monitoring corrosion. Now if I just look at the cross section of some of the products that we might need, we need to have propulsion system components for, let's say, electric propulsion, which can be superconducting motors, advanced induction motors, converters, as I mentioned, magnetic bearings, acoustic coatings, infrared signature suppression devices, shock and vibration mounts, tuned mass dampers, handheld condition monitoring devices, high pressure water mesh system, firefighting systems basically. We need to have meteorological devices which can be used for underwater measurements without having to dock the ship. We need to get into VME hardware, which we can probably manufacture, design and manufacture. Then we need specialized steel as hull material and also weld consumables. We need to look at anti-fouling paintings, coatings, which are environmentally safe. And we need to have automated systems, let's say for cable pulling and so on. Long life paint schemes and surface tolerant paint scheme for bilges. And we need to have radar transparent guardrail ropes with high strength. We need to have transportation solutions for various categories that exist on board. And we may look at, in the software area, we may like to have packages which can be in the area of propulsion system integration and dynamic simulation, for HVAC system, for shock analysis, for integrated full electric propulsion system analysis, for availability, reliability and maintainability studies of the platform and of individual equipment, for survivability and vulnerability studies, which is again important. And we need to have AIP systems which can be modeled and analyzed. And we also need to get into steganography, an area for communication, ship motion analysis. And other niche areas have already been covered in detail by the SA2RM, but I just highlight robotics and artificial intelligence, sensors, photonics, lasers, MEMS, direct energy weapons, material technology, stealth, for stealth, particularly metametals, high energetics, explosives, antimatter, thorium technology, fusion technology, space technology, hypersonics, nano, there is an understanding of nano material science, nano material, but how to convert that into nanotechnology as a product. One of the areas that he mentioned, which is of great interest to us, is to increase the life, operational life of an equipment which does not have a replacement. Is it possible for us to give a coating of some nano material with certain properties which will enhance the properties of the parent material and thereby increase its life? These are areas which we can look into. And of course, biotechnical weapons, the IT and cyber technology that is well known to us, there are a lot many things that can be done there with high computing powers that are available at our disposal. The unmanned vehicles, UAVs, of course, are a potential area for development which has been amply highlighted by the SA2RM. Then we have embedded computation for enhancing performance of weapons and sensor systems, including size reduction. And we need to look at more powerful and versatile decision-making systems we have to be extremely active in a predictive sense and also within the limited time that is available for taking such decisions on board in the face of a threat. And of course, simulation studies for various other requirements. The requirements of training simulators have been highlighted. We need that in each of these areas whenever it is in the process of getting the process of getting converted into a product. It's better to go through a simulator route. It also helps in training of various personnel who are going to be looking after this. And similar such requirements, of course, microelectronic mechanical systems is another area that we may like to look at. These are very few areas that I've highlighted. There are many others. Because of the limited time available, it is not possible for me to get down into details of each one of them. We'll certainly do that in case we have an opportunity to discuss this in greater detail later on. But at this point in time, I am very confident that with the active involvement of several academicians in this country from various institutes and the specific requirements that we highlight from time to time, and with the greater involvement of DRDO as they have been doing all along in also getting the academic institutions on board, and with the Engineering Watch acting as the right launch pad for this great activity, I am sure that we will make progress in all of these niche areas in times to come. On behalf of the Chief of the Naval Staff, I would like to thank the Engineering Watch for giving us this opportunity to put across some of the points that we have in our mind. And I am sure that with greater interaction, we will be able to move into converting these ideas into products of interest to us. Thank you very much.